Hi and welcome to the channel. Today we are going to build another SFF PC using this Lian Li Q58. I bought this for 7,935 pesos or around $135. I also bought a mesh kit panel to test for 862 pesos or around $15. So this has been released for 3 years now, and the actual reason for testing this is that this is the SFF case recommended by Copilot. As for the specs, this can fit an ITX motherboard, a 67mm air cooler, or a 280mm AIO. Max GPU length is 320mm with a good support for an ATX PSU. As for the fan mounts, it has two at the top and possibly one at the bottom if you're good at cable management. There are no pre-installed fans, but it is really generous on SSD mounts with up to 4 potential trays. One is at the back of the PSU mount, second is at the front of the case, third is at the fan mount at the top of the case. So this will lessen fan or radiator compatibility, and lastly at the bottom of the case, and this will lessen the fan mounts as well. There's also a fan and ARGB hub behind, which might be helpful if you plan to maximize the 3 fan slots and you don't like Y splitters. All of this at 14.5 liters in volume. This is like a slightly larger Lian Li A4H2O, but I don't have that right now, so I can't really compare it. But in terms of volume, this is very similar to the Sub D Meshroom D, with Sub D Meshroom D being bigger by 0.5 liters. However, the Meshroom D seems to offer better compatibility in almost all aspects for just 0.5 liters in difference. Anyway, the case is padded by a thick foam and it has a big accessory box at the top. The case is enclosed in a plastic bag. By default, it will come in this standard layout. The top has glass panels while the bottom has mesh panels. At the front, there's a power button, audio jack, USB 3, and USB-A. At the rear, there is a cutout for the motherboard, 3-slot GPU, and there is a power extension plug. There is a warning here to lift up and remove the top panel before removing the glass panels. The reason is that the top panel is actually blocking the side panels.
So as for the accessories, there are magnetic dust filters. There is this thing, it's probably an SSD tray with rubber sheet, Velcro ties, zip ties, spare push pin, some rubber, bunch of screws, really bunch of screws. So it has also fan screws and another set of screws. I think this is what we need. This is seems that based on this I can mount it like this. I think I can replace this with this one, but I'm going to use the AIO.
To open the case, you need to unscrew the middle screw and then lift the top panel up to open. To remove the panels, upon opening, you can pull this backwards. The panels are also held to the case by magnets.
So as for the cables, there is a SATA power, USB 3, audio jack, USB-C, power switch bundle. So I always like this bundled front panel power connectors. And there's an extension cable. And of course, the PCIe riser here.
And the manual.
So apparently, I can remove the front panel as well.
Next is to remove the PSU mount by removing one screw at the front and four screws at the spine. You may need to untie the zip ties as well to properly mount the PSU to the PSU mount.
So next is to install the PSU. So as for the PSU, I'll be using the FSP Dagger Pro 850 watts gold power supply. Should face outwards like so. Then for GPU, you can route it behind the PSU as per the manual, which is good in my opinion. Anyway, let's screw this. So I'm going to use the typical PSU screw. The manual states to plug the power cable now. I think because this is very low, so if I plug it later, I might not be able to plug it properly. Oh, I see. So this power here is for the SSD that you can slot in there. It's kind of smart. So there should be a SATA cable. Yeah, there is a SATA cable which I missed out. But the fan hub doesn't require any supplementary power. Anyway, let's mount the PSU. But for the PSU, they highly suggest that you point this upwards. So this is the PCIe 12VH power.
Tie the PCIe power connector behind the PSU mount, align the PSU mount screw holes to the case, and screw the PSU mount to the case. I find this to be quite difficult as you have to hold the PSU mount while screwing it.
So next is to remove the radiator bracket, which is secured by 4 screws. So they also tell you to actually open this first as you might hit it. Anyway, I forgot to plug this guy. Should plug it here. and of course, turn on the PSU. I think at this point, I can install the motherboard, but the manual isn't really clear on when to install the motherboard. So actually, the manual will tell you to install the motherboard separately. At first, they would want you to have the AIO mounted here, and then install the motherboard, and then mount the AIO to the motherboard. But I don't want to do that, because as usual, my motherboard has the cooler pre-installed.
Anyway, as for the motherboard, I'll be using the Asus ROG Strix B650E-i. Processor is a Ryzen 7 7800X3D. RAM is a G.Skill Trident Z5 Neo RGB 32GB 6000 mega transfer CL30 RAM and DeepCool LT520 for the cooler.
By default, I also mounted it in exhaust mode.
Anyway, I slot the radiator to the top side first before placing the motherboard to the screw holes.
So before I mount the motherboard, I think I'll install the cables first as this is quite tight here. So of course, the CPU 8 pin and then the 24 pin. So there is an HDO. Oh, this is the power switch. So there's an HD audio. I will route it behind the motherboard, see if this will work, and go straight here to the top. Oh, sala sa labat.
Sala sa labat means that it is tangled. So I untangled the cable first and then replug the CPU power connector.
So I routed the HD audio behind the motherboard. I also tried to route this behind the motherboard, but there's basically no more space at the bottom. So there's less clearance for that. So the other thing that you might want to plug now is these guys. So this one and this one. I don't think I need the ARGB now, but I need the fan hub. The fan hub would help me. I don't think I need this. So I'll plug the AIO first. I'm contemplating if I need this. I think I'll just remove it. But right, I can also install the pump cover now. And it has an ARGB. There's also a fan here. By right, I could use this, but I'll get two cables, so never mind. And CPU fan here. Okay, so there are many cables here that I will not use.
Next is I tried to screw the motherboard to the case.
I use the typical motherboard screw. So for this, I really wanted to remove this because it's just a clutter at this point. This way there's less clutter since I don't need the fan hub. Problem is that I might lose the screws. I'll put it here first so that I will not lose it. So I want to remove this because there's two extra cables that I need to manage. Hope I can just pull this out. Okay, so I removed this SSD tray as well because it's two extra cables that I don't need. So again, best to keep the screws within the tray. So I cleared up around four cables, which is good.
Next is to plug the cables.
USB-C, USB-3, and the power switch.
At this point, I try to do some cable management.
So given this, I don't think I can put a fan at the bottom. It's too cluttered there already. I guess the next step is to plug the riser. So remove the cover first, then just plug it to the motherboard. Before I close this, I want to test this out first as well. Seems that my plan won't work. Anyway, given that, plug this out and then do it like so. I think this is more feasible than before. Mount the radiator to the radiator bracket. You don't need to secure it properly first. Okay, so you don't need to secure it so that you can slide it a bit. So nothing is final yet. So that's why you need to only secure this by a few screws at first. So you might miss out things. For example, I missed out this one. So for this, I will undo this first and route the tubes here instead. Okay, this way the cables are tucked. This is it for this side. I'm not sure if this will fit because of the height of the CPU cooler. I think this is quite tall, so I might need to remove this cover later. Anyway, this is good on this side. I just need to secure this thing here.
As for the GPU, I'll be using the Gigabyte RTX 4070 Ti Super Gaming OC.
Anyway, before you install this, remove the PCIe covers. There's just two anyway. Then, I think it's best to plug the PCIe power connector to the GPU first. Just slot it in. And then screw the GPU baffle to the case. Lastly is to secure the radiator. Before I close it, I'll test this out first. Oh, it fits. fits just right. So if I were to ask, I would put the glass at the bottom because that is where my RGB is. Looks weird, but okay. The problem in this layout is that the PSU will be blocked, pretty much blocked. So I guess that's the reason why the glass is at the top by default. I think I'll not suffocate my PSU. It's not worth it.
Anyway, to close the case, just slot back the panels, screw both glass panels, close the front panel, top panel, and then screw the top panel. Upon checking carefully, there is a slight bulge at the motherboard side due to the thick AIO cover. As for possible layouts, out of the box there are four possible layouts. First is the standard layout where the top on both sides are glass while the bottom are mesh panels. Second is where the top are both mesh while the bottom are both glass panels. Third is the motherboard side having glass panels while the GPU side have mesh panels. Fourth is the GPU side having glass panels while the motherboard side have mesh panels. Among the four combinations, the glass sides are on the same side, either top, bottom, left, or right. You can't really have a diagonal glass and mesh panel combination since the glass panel isn't interchangeable thanks to the screw mount at its side. Anyway, as for the temps while benchmarking Cinebench R23 in 30 minutes, the CPU temps averaged at 88.96 degrees Celsius with a max of 90 degrees Celsius. This is slightly cooler than the fractal mood but also slightly worse than the mesh room D by 1.5 degrees Celsius to 2 degrees Celsius. As for Cinebench R24 in 30 minutes, the CPU temps averaged at 85.11 degrees Celsius in its standard config. It is slightly cooler if one side of it is closed, and it is a degree cooler if the panels are all mesh. While testing, I noticed that there is less air going out from the top, so I tried to remove the top panel to see the effect, and it is 2.5 degrees Celsius cooler. As for FF15 in 4K for 30 minutes, the CPU temps averaged at 72.54 degrees Celsius in its standard config. When the motherboard side is glass and the GPU side is mesh, it is slightly cooler by 0.44 degrees Celsius. And with all mesh side panels, it is cooler by 1.5 degrees Celsius. This is a bit hotter than Cooler Master's default config. As for the GPU temps, I find this chart kind of weird and I only have a theory for this. First is that the full mesh is considered quote-unquote the worst config at 65.75 degrees Celsius. Though the standard config isn't really that cooler at 65.51 degrees Celsius or just 0.24 degrees Celsius cooler. The weirder part is that having a closed motherboard side made the GPU cooler by 1.47 degrees Celsius. But maybe not that weird if you think about it. Remember that air pressure would always equalize itself. And for simplicity purposes, I would have one arrow of air as base unit. Also do note that this representation is not accurate, obviously. Anyway, let's say that the AIO exhaust would have two arrows of active air. With that, the case would have two arrows of passive air and it would seep through the mesh and other holes of the case. The passive air from the GPU side may be bigger as there is an active fan from the GPU. Anyway, even if the top half of the case is blocked, the cold passive air will still flow to the GPU properly. But this probably hurt the CPU temps by a bit because technically this is hot air from the GPU as cold air has no choice but to go through the GPU. And blocking the motherboard side would force the air to go through the GPU side only. With the help of the GPU fan, bigger parts of the air will go through the GPU as well. And this helped the GPU temp significantly in my opinion. However, this also means that the PSU will definitely be void of air and could potentially damage your PSU. I could also do a long explanation why the CPU is cooler with the full mesh, but I think these arrows would suffice. Anyway, I tried to test it with glass at the bottom. The CPU was doing okay, but the GPU was suffocated. I tested it for around 6 minutes, and you could see here that the GPU is 75 degrees Celsius with the fan spinning at 90% and the hotspot temps reach 100 degrees Celsius. Definitely not good. Overall, the temps in standard config and full mesh config are actually acceptable. However, I don't see a compelling reason why I should buy the mesh panels. If it's just for 1.5 degrees Celsius cooler CPU temperature, I'll just probably ignore it. As for the comments to the case, well, the manual included was bad in my opinion as it wasn't step by step, but the online manual somehow made up for it. But as compared to other big brands such as Fractal and Cooler Master, Lian Li's manual is basically below standards. While the glass and mesh panels are technically swappable, it isn't really practical. At all other options, you will just unnecessarily suffocate PSU or the GPU. or both. Of course, unless you are doing custom loops. Furthermore, the required removal of the top panel made working with the case to be slightly more complicated. As there is also glass on both sides, it also means that you have to remove those first if you want to lay flat your case while working on it. Again, just slightly more complicated maintenance. Another thing is that the SFX PSU mount could also be improved. A good mechanism, for example, is from NR200P. Rather than relying plainly on screws to mount, they used clamps to hold the PSU temporarily, and then just two screws at the bottom to secure. As for the top panel removal, I always mistakenly lift the fan hub instead of the actual top panel handle. I'm not sure if there's a better position for this, but that's what I experience anyway. Overall, I can't really think of a good reason why I should buy the Q58 in 2024. The compatibility isn't really astounding, the performance is slightly subpar with new cases, it isn't that smaller of a footprint, the price isn't really that competitive, and I'd probably buy this at $100, but not $130. Maybe if you like the built-in fan hub, built-in SSD tray, maybe it could justify it a bit. Also, maybe in 2021, this was good enough, but not for me in 2024. Anyway, that's it for this video. Do let me know in the comments below on what you think of this case. Thanks for watching. Do like or dislike, and subscribe for more unboxing, SFF build, and benchmarks. Bye!